mama told me when I was young, we're all born superstars.
Mama had a lot of advice to all of us. Didn't often take it. You don't realize you're somebody else's mama, that your mama was right. Mama's always right. Hi, everybody. I'm Debbie Nigro. Somebody's mama. That's why I know. Sitting here with Mama Mo. Hello, Mo. Kyle, is your mother always right? Yes, she is, of course.
Glamma.
Glamma. Glamma. Yes, I call you Glamma. All the women out there who are ageless, timeless, and delusionally young, like us, who end up being grandparents.
Yes.
We call them glammas.
Glammas.
Because we don't think anybody should be grandma. That's old people. We don't do old people.
and just for the record, if I don't say my mother is a great mother, the locks on the doors get changed. just
so. So obviously smart she boy. Has made an impact on you.
Smart boy. Apparently
smart
you don't cook
mother.
For yourself yet, Kyle.
Or your, do your own laundry.
Oh, he does.
Or pay your own phone bill.
He does.
I don't know. How long can you pay somebody's kid's phone bill till they're what, 60? I don't know. I don't understand.
Older.
Older.
Could be older.
That's when you're really in trouble. Okay. So anyway, wonderful woman about to join us. I was just recently introduced to her and how fabulous she is. She is the executive director of what's called Amman Imman. Water is life, basically. And her name is Ariane Kirtley. She is a Fulbright scholar. She was doing public health research and watched back when kids traveling up to 30 miles a day looking for water almost in vain. I mean, that's a really hard thought when we so, you know, take for granted turning on a faucet, even if it is frozen today. So I thought it'd be really nice to say hello to her, see what she's doing. What's the latest? Welcome to the show, Ariane.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me, Debbie.
Where are you calling us from today? Where are you?
I'm in Washington, D.C. right now.
Is that where you live and reside and do your best work, Ariane?
Well, no, the NGO is based out of D.C., but I'm usually in Niger, in West Africa, Niger in West Africa, or in France, where my husband and I'm part French. So,
oh, that's
so we
lovely.
Kind of travel across the world, yeah.
You are quite the unique person. A lot of people intend on doing good for the world, but you're doing something pretty impressive here. I want you to tell everybody about the program, Amman Imman, and then about the Friendship Caravan. So take your time and we're all ears.
Okay, well, thank you again. Well, I founded Amman Imman Water is Life, American nonprofit, in 2006 when I, as Debbie said, found children traveling up to 30 miles a day on their donkeys looking desperately for water, and many of them not succeeding. And half of the children that I was meeting, literally, there are 500,000 people living like this, but half of the children were literally dying before age 5, and mostly due to just lack of water.
That's horrible. You want to put it in perspective to the listeners, I'm going to just do this for a second. If anybody's ever had to take a medical test and they tell you don't drink any water after midnight, you almost like freak out thinking, how can I not drink water until the time I go to this thing? I mean, I think about how small a space of time that is for one moment in your life, and then try and imagine not having any water. It's heartbreaking.
Yeah. And so they not only don't have water to drink, they don't have water to bathe with. They might take a bath once or twice a year when it actually rains. But the beauty is that there is actually water. It's a huge region the size of Florida where people are living like this. And the beauty is that there's water underneath the Earth's surface, but you have to drill 600 feet or over. And so after I left the Azawakh, it's called the Azawakh Valley of Niger, I tried to get help from other NGOs, from the government, to bring water to the people living there, to the communities. And nobody wanted to do anything. They're too remote. It's too costly. You know, I heard every excuse in the world not to help them.
Well, I have to ask you, how were they living? I thought you cannot live without water at all. If there was no water and it was under the bedrock, you know, 600 feet down, how were they living?
Well, that's a very good question. And why are they there to begin with? Well, this what's happened is that they used to have water. It used to rain maybe 4 or 5 months out of the year, and they would live from marshes. And so they would drink dirty water, but they would have water from marshes. And then over the past 10 years, the rainy season has gone from 5 months to not even 1 month. And so the people have lived in this area for centuries. It was the best pastoral land in all of West Africa. And so when I went there in 2006, they were still trying to live off of the marsh water, but then that was drying up, and they basically had water 3 months out of the year. And then they would travel to very, very deep wells that were over 300 feet deep, and would try to live off of that water, but then that water would dry out. And then that's why I'm saying that many people were literally dying of thirst. But this wasn't how things have always been there. It's a new thing in their history.
So what did you do? Were you able to get somebody to come over there and drill down and create access?
Exactly. Well, so what happened is that my husband told me, Ariane, you have to be the first to bring water to these people. So that's what we did. He helped me, and then I got several people in America to help me, and we've been raising money. Mostly individuals have been contributing. We've been working with over 100 schools across the world, really, to raise money, and we've been able to pay their drilling companies in the country, just not in that region. And we've gone in, and not only have we drilled water for over 100,000 people thus far, we've also been able to bring help with food, help with schools, help with gardening projects and reforestation projects. So we've actually been able to do a lot.
Congratulations to you to make a difference in the world. You know, I always say one person can make a difference. You've obviously made an amazing difference. And I love that you've gotten the kids involved and people involved. They're called Heroes of Compassion, yes?
Exactly.
So it's a network of schools around the world. And they've taken on this mission, right, passionately to help you, all the students. And how are they helping personally? How are the kids helping?
Oh, wow. The kids, well, they do two things. They raise money, and they also raise awareness. So what happens is the kids, they often do what's called Walks for Water. Every year we have Walks for Water where they walk and they get sponsored to walk. They also hold their own events. They have ceremonies that are like the ceremonies of the people in the Azawak, and they raise money that way. The children that we've presented to then go to new schools and present to new schools to get new schools involved, and they do also Amanathons where they might jump rope or hula hoop, and they get sponsored for each hula hoop and each jump rope. So they do, they can have bake sales, they have, they run, they do so many different things, and they also do friendship exchanges where they send little tokens of love, such as bracelets or drawings to kids in the Azawak, and the kids in the Azawak send back tokens of love too, so they develop friendships with kids that they're helping in Africa.
Okay, well, I want to talk about just the nature of what you're pointing out here, is that the climate change, and I'm not going to completely blame it, but it sounds like what's going on around the world is going on in a weird way with people who are used to rainy seasons. So instead of a lot of rain, they're getting none. How many places in the world is this affecting people's existence, this climate change and lack of water?
Wow, I couldn't tell you how many places in the world are being affected, but I mean, I know anywhere from Polynesia to, you know, to Alaska to Africa, but what I have to say is that people that don't believe in climate change, I can't say that it's global climate change, but what I can say in the past 10 years, their climate has changed drastically and in a way that has not, they haven't experienced in centuries.
Got it. So. I have a friend, a business friend, very interesting business friend, who was working on a water initiative. He was Cornell's Entrepreneur of the Year. His name is Kevin McGovern. And he was spending, last we checked in together, an awful lot of his life figuring out how to filter water that existed. Because a lot of the water that does exist is just not drinkable in a lot of these places.
Exactly.
And so they can see it and they can touch it, but they can't, you know, take it in. And he had something really cool going on. He's dedicating his life to making the water come clean with just some sort of new, you know, technology, which would be awesome, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Reminding me, I'm going to invite him on the show, see what he's doing. But you're doing great work, and I just like to showcase women and men who are making an individual difference in the world. And you got a lot of people behind you. How many people are in this organization right now?
People that work for the organization directly, we're a small staff. We're very small. We're maybe five full-time and then with 20 volunteers. But then, as I said, we have, you know, hundreds of children around the world that are also part of the organization.
Can you tell me where you chose the name Amman Imman?
Amman Imman means water is life in the local language, and that's their main saying. Amman Imman, Ar Isudar, water is life, milk is hope. Before you can have hope, you have to have life, which is water.
Do you speak their language fluently now?
Oh, I speak a little bit of their language. I don't speak fluently.
What is the language? What is their language?
Their language, we work mostly with the Tuaregs and the Fulani. So there's Tamashek, which is the main language, but there's also Fulfulde, which is the language of the Fulani people.
Wow.
They're two different languages.
You are an interesting woman. I am so happy to have met you and had you,
you.
Join us, Ariane Kirtley, founder and director of Amman Imman, Water is Life, bringing water and hope to those who have none. So you can take a bow. Keep up the great work. How can we be of help before I leave you?
Well, obviously, we always need more help in the form of donations. So if listeners are compelled to help in that way, they can go to our website, www.waterishope.org. And that would be a fabulous way. If people have children in their schools that would like to join our Wells of Love movement, please contact us through our website, waterishope.org. So those are two major ways that you can help. We also have people running the Marine Corps Marathon for us, so marathon runners can help. Contact us, and we can let you know how you can help.
Okay, you have a wonderful day. Thanks for being part of the show. Great to meet you.
Thank you so much, Debbie. Thank you so much.
Okay,
bye-bye. You too. Have a great year.
You too. Wow, always makes me feel bad I'm not doing more. Should we be doing something else better that we're doing? I like to provide the platform if everybody else is doing great. Maybe that is my purpose on this planet. You know, you always wonder what your purpose is. And it's a good time of year to reassess what it is you're supposed to be doing. In fact, Jane Pauley just came out with a book. I don't know if you caught that, Maureen.
No.
Yeah, she's always been about the calling, the reinvent. And she's got a whole book out. I think it's just coming out about everybody who's reinvented themselves. Maybe we'll get her on the show. So, you know, it's never too late to be somebody and do something cool. Do you ever go back? Remember back in the day when everybody was going to the Peace Corps?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Did you ever think about it for a few minutes back?
No, I didn't.
I did when there was a lot of yelling at the table in my house. I go, I'm going to the Peace Corps. They don't have this over there.
I was a nurse. It was like the Peace Corps for me. Yeah.
I always wondered if I could do it, you know, because friends went. They became part of the Peace Corps, and they just left and went. And it always seemed like such a really wow move.
It is.
It's a wow.
My 17-year-old nephew is already going to Tanzania and different places.
Yeah.
Working out.
What's he doing?
He's helping build houses and playgrounds and stuff like that in undeveloped countries.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, really cool.
I think it's too late for us for the Peace Corps. I would like to maybe like build a house or something for Habitat for Humanity.
You could do that.
Yeah. I'm good with a hammer.
A lot of action around
I'm
here.
I'm good with a hammer. It's very good for getting out aggression. You know that, right? I hammer.
Yeah, we're talking building, not demolishing.
Oh, okay. Jesus. I hate that.
I don't know what you think you're doing.
I hung a picture the other day. I was like, wow, I have potential. How long do you think that picture stayed on my floor before I decided to hang it 4 feet above where it was sitting? How many people have...
How long was it?
You know, that's...
Still there, isn't it?
It's about commitment. It's about commitment and not wanting to commit to that picture right there or making a hole someplace where you didn't really want a hole in the first place in your wall. And I think there's a lot of people who have pictures that are on their floors because they can't commit to where they want to hang them on the wall. It's a problem.
No, it's
a sickness.
It's your problem.
I have to I got to meditate more on this.
Yeah.
I'm going to sit and meditate at floor level with my picture.
You have more than one picture, Debbie. Well, I have like 50 pictures.
Listen,
on your
meditation
floor.
It helps ease anxiety. I'm going to look into that this year. And depression. They found this out. Meditation might be as effective as taking an antidepressant. Did you know that? I'm not depressed. I just want to calm down a little. Maybe I'll learn to meditate and shut up for a few minutes. Well, I'm staring floor level at the pictures that make me anxious because they're on the floor and not on the wall. All right, listen, loving to laugh is one of our things we do here. We love to laugh and have fun. So it's always our pleasure when we get somebody funny to join us. I don't know if you are a viewer of America's Got Talent, but there was a guy who was just so darn funny who was, I think, the second runner-up on America's Got Talent. Taylor Williamson is going to be with us next.